But I pose this question to you. Have you ever been in a situation where you have gone to encourage and inspire somebody who was just down and out? You knew they were down and out by the circumstance. You knew they were down and out by the positionality that they were in. You knew they were down and out by what was happening in their life. And you went with the desire and the intention of cheering them up. And when you got there, they ended up cheering you up. Have you ever been in that scenario where you had every intention in the world of going to bring happiness, joy to someone? And when you got there, they ended up cheering you up. Ever been in a situation where you've gone to the hospital and you have gone to pray for somebody? And something about being there asks you to do the unthinkable, to actually ask the person in the hospital bed to pray for you. Have you ever been that scenario? Folks all around the world are celebrating Dr. King this week, and we certainly give God all the glory for that life, for his life, for his legacy. And I often wonder, what was it about Dr. King that folks were threatening him, bombing his home, and wanting harm upon him, that he would continue week after week, day after day, hour after hour, to get up and encourage and inspire people? I really believe that he was one aligned for a breakthrough. I believe that he did the things that he needed to do for her. But I believe that in those moments that he reached out and grabbed that breakthrough and claimed it for himself. The breakthrough, if you work here with us, is that transitional, transformative moment where obstacles, detours, or distractions can no longer keep you from accomplishing your goal. That transitional, transformative moment. And this evening, we're going to listen to the Apostle Paul to give us a secret. Not really a secret, it's here. But to give us the secret of life, as he taught it, to how to grab that breakthrough. If you have your Bibles, Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I'll repeat this because it's important. Again, I will say, rejoice. So in that fourth verse, we have rejoice. And then verses 10 through 13, Paul says, I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ, who strengthens me. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I'll say, rejoice. There is a difference between happiness and joy. There's a difference between happiness and joy. Happiness is based on the happenings of one's life. Happiness is circumstantial, based on a situational moment. One can have a moment of happiness. One can have a season of happiness. But happiness is dependent upon the happenings in life. But joy is a decision. Yes. Happiness is situational. But joy is a decision. One can have moments and one will have moments in life where you are just not happy. Things happen in your life that you are not happy about. But joy is a decision. You make your mind up that in all things, you will rejoice and be joyful. There's a difference between happiness and joy. Paul is writing this letter sitting in the prison in Rome. And at one moment, the church of Philippi, a church that he had started, was sending him gifts. And Paul chose not to receive the gifts because he wanted those folks to know, that church to know, that he didn't do all that he did for monetary gain. He says, here, take this back. And it wasn't mail, it wasn't freight mail, it was somebody who walked miles upon miles upon miles to bring that gift. He said, thank you so much, but take it back. And then they sent him another gift. And this time, he received it. Paul made the conscious decision that no matter how hard things were, he was going to rejoice. I mean, let's think about this. At one moment in his life, he was rich, wealthy, beyond all means. Now he finds himself impoverished and in prison. At one moment in his life, he was the ruler of all things. I mean, he could walk around and tell folks what to do, when to do it, how to do it. And now he's taking orders in the prison. Paul is not happy. But he writes these words to the church, reminding them that no matter what scenario, circumstance, or situation you're in, you can choose to be joyful. Right. You walk into a situation, you try to bring cheer to somebody, and they're sitting up, smiling, just as happy as can be. And you're confused and perplexed because you're trying to figure out, I know what you've just been through. You walk into the hospital room knowing that somebody is yay close to the end, but they smile and they're joyful and you're perplexed. They're not happy about the situation, but they made a decision to be joyful. Yes. Now let's go a little deeper here because Paul doesn't stop there. He doesn't stop there. He says, I rejoice greatly. And now the length you have revived your concern for me. The Bible teaches about being a cheerful giver. But one of the lessons that we most often don't teach is how to be a humble receiver. We often think that life is about giving and giving and giving and giving until we get tapped out. And then we get tapped out and we want to disappear and check out. And we want to check out and we want to cut everybody off. Because I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired and I did this. And somehow the resolve is that because I did this, you should. If I were you, I would. And the notion is that the Bible teaches how to be a cheerful, but there's a notion about being a humble receiver. You've aligned yourself and prepared yourself for a breakthrough. You've done the things that you need to do waiting for the breakthrough. And somebody walks into your life and says, listen, I want to introduce you to, oh, no, I don't need that. Or, can I give you a little advice? No, I don't know you. Or I know we've never met before, but I just have, just something about, I want to share something with you. No, I don't know you. I mean, how many times have you been in a situation of predicament where somebody walks up to you and it seems like they're on a mission and they want to share something and you get, God works in mysterious ways. You've aligned yourself. You've done the action to put yourself right in the midst of the breakthrough. But the breakthrough comes right at you and wants to, and you don't want it. often desire for mentors and for spiritual elders in our lives, for people who will care about us and pray about us. And you introduce to somebody, but they don't look like what you think that person should look like, so you keep moving. There's somebody waiting to love you for free, as we say here. A community who wants to receive you into the body just to nurture and encourage you. But that preacher, he wears jeans when he preaches. I mean, how many times have you missed the moment?
Yes, sir.
And then you walk off and you think about it, oh my goodness. And you backtrack and the person is gone. The opportunity is gone.